And we have to know our own systems. And we have to be willing and courageous enough to change the systems, to create something that does work for the system that we're addressing. And that's what my principal did. And I thought it was so cool. So then when I went back to school after 3 months, every day, he came to my house and taught me my curriculum. Every single day after school. I thought that was pretty cool. But then when I went back, like all of a sudden I was a superstar. I had all this notoriety. Everybody at school knew me. But they didn't, I knew that they didn't like me because I was the sassy little girl with gray hair. They liked me because I was on TV every day. And the media was camping out in their front yards, waiting just to get a photo of me. Staying in my neighbors' houses, watching from the windows with their cameras. Just so violating. And it took a few years for me to become my own. But kids are mean, right? When they're scared, they're mean, and they say hurtful things. And when their parents are scared, they say hurtful things. I was no longer invited to birthday parties. I was no longer allowed to have kids come to my house because clearly my parents don't know how to watch children. So nobody was allowed over. Nobody was allowed to have me over. So it became lonely again. And I knew that I didn't belong. And my focus was just to be there for other people. That's all I knew how to do. So when I was in seventh grade, that went on all the way. Until seventh grade, I was slowly starting to find my way, but not really. I still didn't belong anywhere. I knew that I couldn't trust anybody or anything. But I was really, really nice to everybody. Because I learned very quickly, if I make other people happy, then they're gonna be nicer to me, right? So their happiness is way more important than mine. So that was my goal, was just to make everybody feel like they mattered. Because I knew what it felt like not to matter. And that hurt. And so in seventh grade, at Christmas, my mom taught at Head Start, because I went to Head Start for 2 years after my kidnapping, and it was also a huge, huge system for me that helped me grow and advance and learn to socialize and learn to trust again. And so then my mom started working at Head Start, and so for 15 years she worked at Head Start, but in December, it was icy and school systems don't always have enough resources, and especially Head Start, and my mom, there was a big patch of ice on the ground, and she was standing on it, lifting the kids over to get up the ramp to go into her classroom. Well, one of the little kids slipped or did something crazy, and my mom then slipped and fell. And it caused her brain to shift. She broke her tailbone. But it also caused her brain to shift. And my mom apparently had been born, we didn't know this until this moment, but she was born with a brain malformation called Arnold-Chiari malformation, which is where your cerebellum is too big for your brain. And back then, most people who had Arnold-Chiari died at about age 10, 11, when the skull stopped growing, and then the brain pushed so much pressure on it that it kill you from brain pressure. So we learned really quickly. My mom's organs started failing and brain fluid stopped going down and producing what it needed into her body, and she became paralyzed and lost her sense of smell and had these atrocious headaches that felt like she was being shocked, and she was dying. So she was ordered to have emergency brain surgery, and they gave her a 10% chance of living. And so imagine having a huge abandonment disruption at the age of 3, and then here I am at 13, having just gone through like my own development as a young lady, to lose my mother again, I didn't fare so well. So we prepared to say goodbye to my mom, we planned a funeral, we all, you know, had the chaplain out, it was pretty intense, and she lived, but she was never the same. She had four brain surgeries since then, and she's bitter and angry and hurt and in pain all the time. And she's had a rough go. Her life has not been. that helped me go through all of this. And there had to be a reason that I was constantly being given these horrific experiences. I had to explain it. And so in my mind, my explanation was that I was an angel. That God had brought me into this world as an angel, and I was there to help other people. It was not about me, but I was a very sacrificial angel. And that I could take anything because I was an angel, right? And angels are like, you know, you can touch them and they don't feel it. That's what I thought. I really genuinely believed that. And so I got entrenched in my faith, and in going to church, and going to youth group, and reading the Bible, and reading and learning and being, and just being held by that, by something bigger than me. And it was great. Until I went to church camp. And it was a 4-night church camp, and I thought I'd be okay because my brother was with me, but I wasn't okay because my parents weren't. And so on night 3, I had a complete meltdown. My youth pastor and his wife come to me and I say, "But I'm an angel, I should be able to handle this." And they say, "Lori, there's no such thing as angels. You're not an angel. You're just a human being that's had a really hard life." And I just lost it. Everything that I believed in and counted on, and like, it was like that trust game where it's like, "Hey, fall, right, and I'll catch you." I've never done that with another human before.